नमस्कार. तुमकां सगळ्यांक माया मोगाचो येवकार. ह्या राष्ट्रीय स्तरावेल्या व्याख्यानमाळेन तुमकां खूब खूब येवकार. राजभाषा संचालनालयान नॅशनल ट्रान्सलेशन मिशन म्हळ्यार राष्ट्रीय अनुवाद मिशन केंद्रीय भाषा संस्थान मैसूर हांच्या जोड पालवान ही व्याख्यानमाळा आयोजीत केल्या. आयज व्याख्यानमाळेची सुरवात जाता. आमकां आयज मार्गदर्शक म्हूण लाभल्यात डॉक्टर तारिक खान, जे नॅशनल ट्रान्सलेशन मिशनाचे ऑफिसर इन्चार्ज आसात. तुमकां सगळ्यांक येवकार. हांव सगळ्यांत पयली विनवणी करता राजभाषा संचालनालयाचे संचालक प्रसन्न बाब आचार्य, ताणी सगळ्यांक येवकार दिवचो आनी प्रास्ताविक उलोवप करचे.
नमस्कार. तुमकां सगळ्यांक येवकार. द डायरेक्टरेट ऑफ ऑफिशियल लँग्वेज इज एस्टाब्लिश्ड फॉर डेव्हलपमेंट अँड इम्प्लिमेंटेशन ऑफ ऑफिशियल लँग्वेज इन द स्टेट ऑफ गोवा. द कोर कॉम्पिटन्सी ऑफ द डिपार्टमेंट इन्क्लूड्स इम्पार्टिंग ट्रेनिंग ऑफ बेसिक नॉलेज ऑफ कोंकणी लँग्वेज, सो ऑल्सो असिस्टिंग वेरियस डिपार्टमेंट्स ऑफ स्टेट अँड सेंट्रल गव्हर्नमेंट इन ट्रान्सलेशन ऑफ वेरियस डॉक्युमेंट्स इन्क्लुडिंग ॲक्ट्स, रूल्स, स्कीम्स, citizens charters, etc. The department has also taken the initiative of coining of scientific and technical terms in Konkani language in collaboration with Commission for Scientific and Technical Terminology, New Delhi. Some of these are already published and others are at final printing stage. The department publishes research-oriented books. This department has also taken lectures on basic Konkani language and language orthography. This department is in the process of preparing a basic learner's course in Konkani language and printing it in book form. Since translation work has tremendous potential in the era of social networking and artificial intelligence, it was felt necessary to collaborate with National Translation Mission, Central Institute of Indian Languages, Mysuru, and conduct lecture series as a part of promotion of translation culture and emerging translation industry among the budding translators as well as amateur and professional translators. The lecture series aims to create awareness about translation, develop skills of translation, above all, improve quality of the translation by facilitating the translators to find key to the minds of the author of the material which is translated, retaining the soul of the original work in the body of the translation undertaken by the translators. I am optimistic that this lecture series will benefit the budding translators and will be a turning point in creation of the translation industry. Thank you.
देव बरें करूं सर. सरान जशें म्हणलें तशें आमचें जें संचालनालय आसा जे ते अनुवादाचें काम नेटान करता. आमचे कडेन हांगा अनुवादक आसात, तेच प्रमाण कितलेशेच खाजगी अनुवादक आसात जांकां सेगीत अपडेटेड रावचें पडटा, जांकां जे अनुवादाचे वेगवेगळे टूल्स आसा तांचे विशीं म्हायती जाणून घेवपाची इत्सा आसता. हाचेच खातीर आमच्या संचालनालयान राष्ट्रीय अनुवाद मिशनाच्या जोड पालवान ह्या व्याख्यानमाळेचे आयोजन केला. हांव आता विनवणी करता राजभाषा संचालनालयाचे सहाय्यक संचालक अनिल बाब सावंत हांचे कडे, ताणी आमच्या मार्गदर्शकाची सगळ्यांक वळख करून दिवची.
नमस्कार. नॅशनल ट्रान्सलेशन मिशन आणि राजभाषा संचालन गोंय सरकार, गव्हर्नमेंट ऑफ गोवा, आमी लॅक्चर सिरीज ऑन ट्रान्सलेशन स्किल घडोवन हाडटा आनी ह्या लॅक्चर सिरीज ही आयच्यान सुरवात जाता. ह्या लॅक्चर सिरिजा खातीर आमकां जे पयले फॅकल्टी मेळ्ळ्यात ते म्हळ्यार डॉक्टर तारिक खान, लॅक्चरर कम ज्युनियर रिसर्च ऑफिसर, सेंट्रल इन्स्टिट्यूट ऑफ इंडियन लँग्वेजीस, ऑफिसर इन चार्ज ऑफ द नॅशनल ट्रान्सलेशन मिशन. आय वेलकम डॉक्टर तारिक खान फॉर दीस लेक्चर सिरीज. डॉक्टर तारिक खान हे भाषांतर अनुवाद ह्या क्षेत्रातले एक नामांकित व्यक्ती, एक नामांकित फॅकल्टी, तांचो अणभव आयज आमच्या लेक्चर सिरिजाक मेळटा हे म्हणल्यार आमकां ताचो खूब अभिमान आसा. आणि त्याच वांगडा तांचे मार्गदर्शन आमकां मेळटकीच ही अनुवाद प्रक्रियेक आता एक बरी गती मेळटली. आणि हे करता आसतना आयज ह्या लेक्चर सिरिजाची सुरवात अशी जाता की डॉक्टर तारिक खान एक अशें म्हणू येता आमच्यान की तांचे कडेन तांची शिक्षणीक तांची जी कारकीर्द आसा ती सामकीच बरी उंचेली आसा. डॉक्टर तारिक खान हांचो ह्या अनुवाद क्षेत्रा कडेन खूब इंट्रस्ट आसा आनी त्या खातीर तांच्यांनी सायको लिंग्विस्टीक, ह्युमर स्टडीज, सोशियो लिंग्विस्टीक, रायटींग सिस्टीम, ट्रान्सलेशन स्टडीज आनी इंटर कल्चरल प्रॅगमॅटिक्स हातूंत तांच्यांनी खूब वावर केल्लो आसा. हांगासर येवच्या पयलीं तांच्यांनी गॅस्ट फॅकल्टी हांगा सेंटर फॉर एप्लायड लिंग्विस्टीक आनी ट्रान्सलेशन स्टडीज हैदराबाद युनिवर्सिटी हांगासर तांच्यांनी काम केलां आनी थंयच तांच्यांनी एम फील, पी एच डी ह्यो तांच्यांनी डिग्री आत्मसात केल्या. हांव तांचें स्वागत करतां, हांव तांकां येवकार दितां आनी त्याच वांगडा आयची ही व्याख्यानमाला लेक्चर सिरीज ऑन ट्रान्सलेशन स्कील ही यशस्वी जातली आनी सगळ्यांक ताचो बरो लाभ मेळटलो आनी तांचें मार्गदर्शन आमच्या गोंय सरकाराक, आमच्या राजभाशा संचालनालयांतल्या सगळ्या अनुवादकांक, तशेंच हांगासर हाजीर आशिल्ल्या सगळ्या अनुवादक फायदो जातलो अशें हांव आवडेन.
देव बरें करूं सर. Now I request our resource person to enlighten us on the topic Introduction to Translation and Interpretation, म्हळ्यारूच अनुवादाची वळख आनी ताचे विस्कटावणी. I request you, sir, to deliver the lecture to us and after which we shall take questions from our audience. Thank you.
Honorable Director श्री प्रसन्न आचार्य जी, अनिल सावंत जी, असिस्टेंट डायरेक्टर, डायरेक्टरेट ऑफ लैंग्वेजेस, गवर्नमेंट ऑफ गोवा, मिस स्नेहा सबनिस जी, श्री सेबी फर्नांडिस जी, इट्स माय प्लेजर टू बी पार्ट ऑफ दिस प्रोग्राम व्हिच इज हैपनिंग इन कोलैबोरेशन विथ बिटवीन नेशनल ट्रांसलेशन मिशन and Directorate of Languages on a very important issue, that is translation. It's my pleasure to be part of this program and contribute to it as a resource person. At the start, I would like to draw your attention to some very common facts, some facts which are treated as axioms and they don't require too many justifications. They don't need to be proved. So I would like to begin with some facts and argue in favor of translation and interpretation with an aim to inform the august listeners, the translators of Directorate of Languages, and anybody who is viewing this program on the virtual platform, on some subtleties, some issues that are very important, that are important to understand translation activities, that are important to understand the significance of translation and interpretation in the development of human society itself. The first point that I would like to present before you is that translation and interpretation are as old as human language itself. And the reason behind saying this is that there was never a situation when human beings had only one language. What I would like to emphasize on is the fact that human beings have always had more than one language. There were several languages and they were interacting. So when there were so many languages and human beings were always interacting, then how was that interaction happening? Possibly through translation and interpretation. That means translation and interpretation have been there for ages. It is not a new phenomena. The second point that I want to present before you is also very important. The amount of knowledge that we have, the wealth of knowledge that we have developed about science, about social sciences, about technology, about so many things. We have knowledge about medicine, we have knowledge about human body, we have knowledge about food, we have knowledge about clothes. All that would not have been possible if all of it were to be collected in a single lifetime, in a single language. It has actually passed on from one community to another community, one language group to another language group, possibly through translation and interpretation. That means we at present have inherited a lot from our past, a lot from those who lived before us, and a lot from those who are living in different places across the globe. So any development that takes place somewhere gets translated and interpreted and reaches to the people who are in need of that. The third point that I want to inform you about is, like, when the activity of translation and interpretation have existed for a long time, in some cultures, in some languages, they have been formalized. There have been institutional developments for that activity, institutional interventions for such activities, and due to which we have several technical terms to refer to translation and interpretation. In some cultures, there may be one or two terms. In some cultures, there may be more. And in some cultures, there may not be some terms also. But what is important for us to understand is the activity has been there. Let me also bring before you another very important point. That is something that we need to assign to translation and translators, and that is related to the value that we usually attach with translation and translators. It is not a surprise, it is a very commonly visible fact that translation is an intellectual activity. Interpretation is an intellectual activity. It is not just a leisurely pastime. In fact, it is something that requires an individual to know what is written in the source text, what is written in the text that is to be rendered in a different language or in a different variety or in a different medium. So in order to do that, apart from proficiency in language, one also needs to be aware of the subject matter, and that requires the individual to know and understand them well and also know and express them properly. So that way we can very confidently say that a knowledge society would be hard to imagine if translation and interpretation were not there. Without translation and interpretation, it would not have been possible to create a knowledge society or to imagine a knowledge society which will depend fully on knowledge. Now, despite these arguments, there are some hard or harsh realities. Let us also examine them. Despite the fact that translation is very important, interpretation is very important, despite the fact that it has contributed, translation and interpretation have contributed significantly to the development of human society, we still see that translation and interpretation, translators and interpreters are not regarded very well, they are not paid well, they are not recognized properly, they are not treated on par with scholars in other disciplines also. Very often, I have come across people saying that I would like to read the original if that existed. Very often, people would say it is a translation of something, so it is of lesser value. Very often we see that the interpreters are treated like service providers who are not valued for all the skills that they have. So there is a need to revisit our own attitudes towards translation and interpretation. There is a need to re-examine how we treat these two very important human activities. There is a need to readjust our attitude towards translation and interpretation and recognize these very important language activities as something that is scientific, something that is on par with any other scholarly activity, something that can help us achieve our goals in technological fields also, something that can create peace in the world, something that can create understanding among nations. So that's how translation and interpretation are very important. And for these reasons, I should like to thank the Directorate of Languages, Government of Goa, for organizing this series of lectures in which the experts from National Translation Mission would be discussing various topics that are very, very important in these two areas. Today, with a purpose, I have chosen to introduce before you translation as well as interpretation. I shall be coming to that in next few slides. Let me just begin with some preliminaries. Let me present before you what kind of activities translation and interpretation are. Let us just see them as the following activities. Translation and interpretation are language activities. It's a very commonly accepted fact that all these things are happening between and among and within languages. Occasionally, there are also instances when translation or interpretation can happen between mediums in which there is language on one hand side and sign or symbol on the other hand side. So there can be instances of sight translation. There can be instances of interpreting sign language. That's a different thing. But on the whole, these are all language activities. These are linguistic activities. That also implies that translators and interpreters are linguists who understand languages, even though they do not analyze the structures of language, even though they may not be able to explain the grammar, they may not be able to tell you what sound patterns are available in the language, but they are very well versed in passing on a message from one language to another language, or from one variety of a language to another variety, or from one medium, which is language or not, linguistic or non-linguistic, to another medium that is linguistic or non-linguistic. So that way, translation and interpretation are linguistic activities, and they are very, very important within the discipline of linguistics and in other adjacent disciplines as well. Translation and interpretation are also intellectual and knowledge-based activities. If we look at what kind of translations are happening mostly, we'll be surprised to see that on the one hand, there is a lot of translation and interpretation activities happening for literary texts. On the other hand, there is a lot of translation activities happening for scientific texts. there is a lot of interpretation activities happening in court and tourism sectors. When these things are happening, we are very well sure that these are knowledge-based activities, and for somebody to understand it fully and express it in the desired or target language, it is an intellectual activity, and it requires a lot of reading and understanding and expressing it in the desired language and culture properly. Translation and interpretation are also creative and aesthetic activities. These are creative and aesthetic activities because there are instances when translators and interpreters come across gaps. There are instances when interpreters come across cultural gaps. That means there is something which is present in the source language, and it is difficult for the translators or interpreters to express the same in the target language, for which the translators and interpreters instantly or immediately adjust to something, or they provide alternatives. They provide alternatives so that the communication does not fail and things are expressed out properly and desirably. So that way they become very creative and aesthetic experts, people who can pass on message and also improve it or work on it and render it creatively in another language. Yes, translation and interpretation have existed as playful and leisurely activities also. People who had their own interest have engaged in these activities and have chosen these activities as their hobbies, for which we can say today translation and interpretation can also be chosen as important hobbies, which also can have financial returns, which also can have employment opportunities. These are also activities which are treated as scientific and technological. Scientific in the sense that the activity of translation and interpretation is based on some very well defined, some very well organized rules. It cannot be just any like disorderly activity. In fact, it's very orderly and it is very systematic. So that way it is scientific, but at the same time it is also a scientific and technological activity, because translation of a technological development anywhere in the world requires translation of the of that in another language, another culture, in a different locality. So therefore any new technological development, say invention of a new machine or development of a software or a program or anything, it can be a gadget, it can be mobile technology, anything that comes as a development in the world also requires it to be localized and made available in different parts, and for which those who are in need are very much ready to pay and receive that service. So that way it is playing an important role for the transfer of technology. That is how we can have a world where there is less or no hierarchy, at least in terms of the availability of technological resources, which is a very, very important goal for the human society. These are also professional activities. These are also economic activities. So people who are professional translators and professional interpreters can earn a good livelihood by engaging in these activities. With these preliminaries, let me bring before you some basic concepts so that the other discussions can go on in a good way. Let me present before you the first concept, that is of translation, and then interpretation and adaptation. These are always placed side by side, and I'm very happy to say that translation often works as an umbrella term. So it often works as a cover term for various activities happening within it. So most of the terms that are appearing before you on this particular screen, this particular slide, are actually covered under translation. But within that, when we talk about translation, the practitioners and scholars of translation often tend to assign the term translation to an activity that has to do with written or printed material. So when a written or printed material is translated, when a written or printed material is or from a source text is rendered into a target text in written or printed form, it is translation. In contrast, if the material is in oral form, if the text itself is in the oral form, that means something is spoken in a language is rendered in another language, then it would be called interpretation. That means translation and interpretation differ on modality. That means translation and interpretation are different because of their modality. So translation is for written and printed materials. Interpretation is for oral materials. Similarly, adaptation is also there. And here we need to understand that often something written in a particular language can be adapted, can be remodeled, can be transmuted, can be expressed in a different medium or in a different form. The formal studies of translation, which is a recent development, is called translation studies. The formal study of interpretation is called interpretation studies or interpreting studies also. And the formal study of adaptation is called adaptation studies. Let me bring before you some more arguments, one of which is, though translation and interpretation differ on modalities, though these are two things within the same kind of activities, we'll see that there is an inclination towards translation. So there are more translation activities happening than interpretation, at least formally, at least institutionally. But if we examine it closely, we'll notice that interpretation is an activity that has preceded translation. We shall be discussing that in subsequent slides also. Here, I would just like to inform you that interpretation has preceded translation. And that way, we can say that interpretation has not received the value it should, even within translation studies or even within translation activities. It is slowly catching up. For that matter, adaptation studies is still catching up. It would require some more time before they are all treated on par and before they gain their truly deserved values. So we have discussed when the activity is at the written and printed material, we call it translation. When the activity is at oral medium, we call it interpretation. And when there is an instance of adaptation, when there is an instance when the material changes or in its shape or format or medium, then we call it adaptation. Another very important, very related concept is that of transliteration. What happens in transliteration is something very interesting. Here the transfer is not from one language to another language. Rather, it's from one script to another script. It's from one set of letters to another set of letters. It is something very interesting because there are occasions when all that is required is the expression of the content in a different script only. So transliteration transliteration refers to an activity when the message from a particular language is recoded, it is expressed in another script. So I am presently speaking English, and this can be expressed in Roman letters. It can also be expressed in Devanagari. It can also be expressed in Perso-Arabic script, or for that matter, any script. So when there is only transfer of the script, we call it transliteration. Very often, when translators face difficulties in translating a particular concept, or when they find it very difficult to express something which is very technical or which is accepted as that particular source language term itself in the target language, then they would just transliterate that. For instance, if we have to use the word mobile or computer or satellite in our languages, we would prefer to just transliterate that instead of trying to coin a new term in our own language. That means when the target language accepts the source language term itself, then this has to be transliterated. Similarly, a systematic expression of the message in a particular script would be called transcription, for which linguists have developed a particular script called International Phonetic Alphabet. And this alphabet is based on the principle of one sound, one symbol, one symbol, one sound. So that is to say that all sounds have received a particular symbol. Though there are thousands of languages spoken in the world, the number of sounds, the number of phonemes is not so many. So that is a small number, just running into some 200 to 300. And using those sounds, one can cover all languages. That means most languages who differ also may be sharing a lot of sounds. That means there can be common sounds between languages which are not even related. So the difference between languages is that of few sounds and not all the sounds. Therefore, if all sounds have got individual symbols, it is easy to transcribe them. So that kind of systematic rendering of message from one script to another script would be called transcription. Similarly, some occasions compel the translators to transcreate and transmutate. So there are occasions when the translators need to, or interpreters need to, come up with new terms. They need to coin terms and they need to express that express a particular concept using euphemism or using some other metaphorical objects or phenomena, so that the flow of communication does not break. There are other similar activities which can engage translators and interpreters, and they involve dubbing and subtitling. These are very important, highly paying areas. They are very rewarding areas. A lot of programs, a lot of movies that are created in a particular language need to be telecast in other languages also, for which there are requirements of dubbing and subtitling. You might have come across some programs, especially children's programs, cartoons, which are originally developed in, say, Japan or China, and then they are telecast in Indian languages, within India, in various languages. So this has been possible because of the developments in dubbing and subtitling areas. We also notice very often that movies and other programs which are popular in a particular place are again remade, or instead of remaking, by the use of subtitling and dubbing, they can be presented in a different language. So these are slightly different from adaptation, because in adaptation there is a possibility of a novel becoming a movie, or a movie becoming a novel, or a book expressed in video form. So here it's slightly different. Here there is just a kind of a voice change, or there are sentences or text appearing at the bottom of the screen. I also should like to introduce you the term source language or source text, which basically refers to the language from which translation has to happen, or the language from which interpretation has to happen. And then target language or target text refers to that language into which translation or interpretation has to happen. There is also a concept of equivalence. We, by our own common sense, can say that when languages differ, when there are cultural differences, there can be occasions when a particular thing spoken in source language is not available in the target language, and therefore it would require it would pose challenges, and it would require some kind of adjustments, some kind of creation, some kind of coining. So equivalence is a term that refers to a similar or a term in the source in the target language that has similar value, that is more or less roughly the same. Now, untranslatability refers to those concepts, phenomena, and situations, or objects, or technologies, or linguistic expressions that would be difficult to express in the target language, and that would require either reuse of that or some kind of new coining, some kind of new development. Similarly, localization is a concept that is assigned to bringing a foreign language term or a foreign language technology or a foreign language concept into a local language. So when say mobile technology developed in Europe and America, and it has seeped into even the remotest part of Asia and Africa, we can very well say that these technologies have not just reached in these places, rather they are also available in the languages spoken in these places. So therefore we can say that it required some kind of an adjustment, it required localization. Similarly, sometimes when a small thing happening in a particular small place becomes very big, becomes very popular, becomes very widespread, then it also reaches to other countries, then there is a need to foreignize those things. There is a need to, I mean, from the point of view of translation, there is foreignization taking place. So localization and foreignization are also two very important concepts associated with translation and interpretation activities. If we look at both these activities, we may also be interested to know at what levels these activities happen. These activities can happen, and they do happen, at various levels. The first among them is at the level of sound and sound patterns. That means there are occasions when the complete translation or the translation of that source text is not required in completeness, rather it is to be rendered only at the level of sounds and letters. So that way, when there is transliteration or transcription happening, we can say that it is operating at the level of sounds and sound patterns, letters, and patterns of letters. Then it can happen at word level and word parts level. That means the complete text is not translated, rather only some words are translated or interpreted. Rest of it remains the same. Then it can happen at the level of multi-word expressions. That means idioms and phrases, or some other quotes and proverbs. They are expressed from one language to another language. They are transferred. Rest of it is understandable for the people. So there are occasions that require the transfer of multi-word expressions from one language to another language, either in written or oral form. Similarly, there can be instances when the activities are operating at the level of single sentences or parts of the sentences. and then subsequently they can go to the larger levels. They can operate at proper words and sentences, and then they can also operate at the level of context. Now this is something very important, and we shall be discussing it in next few slides. The role of a translator or interpreter is not just to pass on the message from as if it were just a say string of words, just a string of sentences, just a few sounds. Rather, they are placed in meaningful context, and the transfer has to happen meaningfully from one context into another context without too much of loss. So the context should not change. It should be fit. It should be appropriate also in the target language without losing things. So that way the translators and interpreters need to understand what exactly a particular statement or sentence means in the source language, and then how that can be best expressed in the target language. We can take instances like when a word like pen has to be translated, it may be easy for somebody speaking Hindi to say this means lekhni or kalam. But if we have to express something which is indirectly said or which has a connotative meaning, then things become difficult. There are also instances when people use irony and satire, or they use metaphors. So in those expressions, in those sentences, we notice that the meaning is not just semantic or lexical in nature. Rather, it is metaphorical, and it has to be understood first and then expressed in the target language. So the levels at which translation and interpretation happen are multiple, and they are not just restricted to one particular one particular level. Rather, beginning from sound and sound patterns, they go to word and word parts, then they go to sentence and sentence parts, and then they further go to larger texts like paragraphs, and then there are focus of discourse, and then there are also gestures, all of which, in fact, the total message have to be transferred. So that way the translators can be asked to, or interpreters can be asked to, operate at any of these levels, and they have their challenges at all these levels. Let me bring before you how the term translation has been perceived, has been discussed in various cultures. You'll see on the screen translation in Latin was translatio or transfere, and it basically meant transporting or to carry over. Then in Bengali and Sanskrit, it was some kind of anuvad and rupantar. In Hindi, still it's called anuvad. But if you look at the intended meaning, you'll notice that there are slight differences. For instance, in Arabic, it is tarjama. And if we look at these terms, and if we look at what they intend in the language in which they have developed, we'll notice two very interesting things. One is there have been several traditions of translation. That means across the globe, across several languages, there have been several traditions of translation. There is not one way, one form of translation, or one style of translation that can be said this is the style and this is what is applicable across the globe. Rather than that, there are several. And then there are several paradigms also. But then another point that we can notice from here is that though there are different traditions, though there are different paradigms in which translation and interpretation activities are happening, language is common there, and the overall objective remains more or less same. So the overall purpose does not change. In fact, that remains the same. That means transfer of message or rendering of message from one language to another language, or from one medium to another medium, is what is required. So let me come back to translation again, and let us examine how translation is happening, what are the forms and types of translation. Roman Jakobson provided three forms of translation, and he discusses in his paper three forms of translation, one of which is intralingual, referring to that translation which happens within a language. So intralingual translation refers to that translation which is happening within a language. That means it can refer to two things. One is either it is just a paraphrase, that means something which I am speaking right now is spoken by another person, or something which I have written is rewritten by somebody else. So it can be paraphrasing, and it can be intralingual. It can also be considered in a different way. That is, if a language has several varieties, and if the message, if the content is spoken in a particular variety and that is expressed in another variety, it can be called intralingual because it is happening or operating within a language. That means any message transferred from one variety to another variety of a particular language would be called intralingual translation. Then the next form, which is very common, which is frequently occurring, and which we all are aware of as translators, is called interlingual translation. In interlingual translation, the message is conveyed from one language to another language. And then we have intersemiotic translation, where translation from one medium or one particular format or one particular platform is rendered into another platform, another medium, another format. We should also examine things like site translation. That means occasions, that refers to occasions when either a person observes things and then expresses it in words. That means some activities are going on and the translator who is doing site translation is just looking at that and then expressing that in the verbal form. So it can be, say, a program going on somewhere and the person is narrating that. Commentators on radio or TV programs, sports commentary can be the best examples of that. Human translation is known to us, any translation activity that is happening by human beings. Machine translation is also an important development that we need to discuss. Machine translation refers to that translation in which there is some kind of autonomy, there is some kind of automation. That means the machine is doing the translation. This is a development that is still in the making, that has not reached its fullness. Also, we need to take into consideration another form which is more commonly used today. Most of the translators who are, even though they are proficient in language, are making use of machine tools, for instance, computers and internet. And therefore, they can be called machine-aided translation or machine-aided human translation. So these are machine-aided translations are human translations, but there is support of machine in those translations. So a good term to refer to that particular form of translation would be machine-aided human translation. The translation activities are very interesting. There have been instances of multiple translation. So a text expressed in a particular language can be referred in another language, and they have happened. But there are occasions when multiple translations have happened. So a text which is expressed in multiple translations indicates several things. First, one translator who translated it did whatsoever he or she could do. The other translator might not have been satisfied with the first translation and might have provided an alternative translation. That means there may or may not be one single form of translation. That means when the source text is open for interpretation, the target text should also be multiple in number. That means if you and I can interpret the source in different ways, that then therefore when we are translating, we may come up with different kinds of translation. So one very interesting technique that emerged for translators was back translation. That means if a translator has translated something, that translated text is passed on to another translator who would translate it back to the source language without knowing that this activity or this particular thing that he or she is translating is actually a translation. So the source text expressed in the target language or target text is retranslated in the source language, and then it is examined for whether the back translation provides that which was in the source text, that which was in the original, or there is some kind of loss or gain or deviation in the process. So very often back translation works as a benchmark, as a parameter to judge the quality of translation. But then there are problems with back translation. The problem is that any translation activity would require resources. It would require time. It would require investment, depending upon the size of the text. So if it were just sentences like good morning, good evening, or hello and welcome, it would be easy to back translate them. But if it were a say novel which was translated from English to Hindi or English to Konkani, then it would be difficult for the persons evaluating them to retranslate or back translate them, and then only test the quality of the translation. So therefore, these are like important parameters to judge the quality of translation. These are still very expensive and often proving to be impractical. Retranslation happens at several levels. Sometimes the translators themselves would like to revisit their translation and find out how well they have translated or how much they would differ in their next attempt. Let us also look at what kind of texts and what domains and fields of translation are available. This is just a small list here, and it is inexhaustive. It is also very clear that there are several other domains and fields which engage translators. I have just brought before you some domains which are commonly visible, and these are like domains in which a lot of translation activities are happening, a lot of engagement of translators are there. So literary translation comes first. A lot of translation activity has been happening from a very long time, from like very early days. Literary text would be translated, would be expressed in other languages. Religious text would be expressed in other languages. So in literary text, we notice that novels, poems, or fictions, works of fictions or drama would be expressed in other languages. From one language, they would be expressed in other languages. So this is a domain which requires specialized skills among the translators. Examine a situation in which the translator does not take interest in literature itself. Then it would be difficult for that particular translator to understand the literariness or to understand the literariness of the text and also express that in proper literary form in the target text. So any ordinary translator would not be able to translate a literary text. It requires very specialized skill. Somebody who is equally good, who is interested in literature as well as good at expressing them in the other language. Let me also like inform you that most translations in past have happened for religious texts, for the purpose of spreading the messages available in holy scriptures, the messages of various religions needed to be passed on to various cultures and communities. So religious translation has happened for a very long time, and among the most translated texts you have Bible. Then we also notice that in the process it gave a lot of insights to linguistic analysis, a lot of insights to language pedagogy, a lot of insights for second language teachers and learners. So religious translation, though it was happening for the purpose of the expansion of religions or for developing understanding between people of different faiths, it has worked very well for the discipline of language studies, linguistics, and especially language pedagogy. Because of these requirements, a lot of tools could be developed. Then comes political translation. So these are like translations of things happening across the globe and expressed in different languages. So if there is a development happening in, say, America or England or France or Germany, it requires to be known to the Indian people also, and that would require for the general people to understand them, and for the purpose the translation happens at the political level. Then there are commercial translations also. There are many multinational companies, and these companies need to sell their products in different parts of the world, and when they have to sell their products in different parts of the world, they are in need of translation. So these domains of translation are very important. Scientific and technical translations do not require any further justification, because these are like very commonly observed and they are essential requirements for any country. Academic also are very important. Academic translations, things like a particular book which is very important in a particular discipline, needs to be made available in various languages. How far and how well we fare on these fronts is a different thing altogether, but these are requirements, important requirements. Then journalism is also an area which provides a lot of translation opportunities. A lot of translation activities are happening there. Let me draw your attention to the interpretation activities. And as I have mentioned before, translation operates at written and printed material. Interpretation happens at the oral and aural levels. So though the term derives from Latin, and it refers to something which we use it for general conversation. So when something is written or spoken and it's not clear to an individual, the person explaining it to the individual is an interpreter, and there is a need for interpretation here. But here the meaning is slightly different, and in the field of interpretation, especially from the perspective of translation, it refers to that activity which is orally happening, and that activity which is involving passing on message from one language to another language. This activity is nothing new. It is not a new activity. In fact, human beings have been engaging in this kind of activity for a very long time. It is not very new. In fact, if we closely examine human languages, there are fewer languages in which writing and printing happens. In fact, there are more languages in which are unwritten, and in which only oral communication happens. Most of our knowledge and belief systems and our philosophies have also transcended orally. So therefore, we can say that interpretation activities have been there for a very long time, and they are very important across the globe. They are more frequently occurring than translation activities. But for some reasons or the other, interpretation is not regarded on par with translation, and there are more translators in the professional sector, in the areas where employment is happening. There are more translators than interpreters. But recently, there has been some good growth in the field of interpretation also, and there is a lot of requirement for interpreters in various domains and areas. Let us see there the types of interpretation. So there are two main types which are like discussed, and the third one is also commonly observed. One interpretation is called simultaneous interpretation, when things are like spoken in one place and then the same thing is expressed simultaneously in another place, or say in another language. This happens very commonly in, say, conferences or parliament, when a particular minister is speaking something, the same is expressed in a different language to any other parliamentarian for his or her convenience. Then you have another form of interpretation called consecutive interpretation. So in consecutive interpretation, what happens is the person is speaking, takes a pause after speaking for some time, and the same message that he has conveyed is expressed by the interpreter when the pause is there. So in simultaneous interpretation, there is less time for the interpreters. When simultaneous interpretation happens, the interpreter is speaking at the same time. That means there is very little time and the person has a big challenge to understand what the speaker is saying and then express the same in the target language. In consecutive interpretation, there is a little more time and the person can refer to things and then can also look into dictionaries to understand what the speaker has said and then express the same in the target language. Another form is called like whispered interpretation, and this is something which is also very common. Very often you'll notice that there would be a communication going on between two parties who do not know each other's language. So there can be the top leaders of two countries talking to each other, and there are people sitting just, or say there is a person sitting just behind him who would be whispering at a lower pitch. So the speakers maintain whatever pitch they can, but the person who is interpreting it is speaking at a lower pitch, so that only the person who intended to understand that text that was spoken can hear it, and this is called whispering. So this is also very common in many places. You will notice that the talks, the discussions, the deliberations are going on, and there are people sitting behind in say places like courts and all. Also, you will notice that somebody would be whispering and saying it to the next person for his or her convenience. Now, like these are like domains in which you will notice a lot of interpretation activities happening in conferences, when there are there is participation of multiple like representations are there. When there is participation of people from different countries and different languages, then there is a need for expressing all that in the concerned or in the interested languages. At the same time, there is also a need to express it in the sign language. So very often you will notice that the conference proceedings are expressed in the sign language, and that helps the people who do not use verbal language and understand the proceedings properly. Then there are other like areas, for instance, court of law. Court of law also requires translation and interpretation services, and there you will notice very often people who are in some kind of conflict situation, or people who are in need of interpretation, if they are located in a different country whose language they do not know, then they would require the help of a translator or interpreter. And very often interpretation is required in courts and police. Mass media also requires that. In military also it is required. Very often you see dramatists bringing people, or say actors and players from various nationalities would come into a single team, and when they come into a single team, they have to understand each other. For that also there are like requirements of interpretation. Then tourism sector is something that we cannot ignore. It is something very interesting, and it is something which is very promising also. This is one sector where like tour guides take people and explain the local culture. But imagine a situation in which the tour guide does not know the language of the tourists, or the tourist does not know the language of the tour guide. In that case, it would become very difficult. So this is one area where, like, the person who is proficient in both the languages, the person who is very well versed with the local cultures and the significance of the place being visited, and it interprets it for the visitors. So tourism sector is one sector which is like opening a lot of opportunities for interpreters. Now the dilemma before a translator is something that we need to discuss. Like, it is things that I have spoken may look very convincing and may appear easier said than done. In fact, translators often have a very diagonally opposite, like they have choices which are diagonally opposite. That means whether they should focus on words or ideas of the original, whether they should stick to the words or ideas, or whether they should their translation should read like original, or it should read like translation, whether they should follow the style of the original, or they should have style of the translation, whether the translation should read as contemporary of original or translation. I have used the word original here just to refer to source text. Some scholars do not agree to the view that there is anything original. In fact, they would like the source text to be used there, and they would say that the original becomes original because of translation. For instance, Derrida, in his deconstructive perspective on translation, would say that translation makes the original. So original becomes original because of translation. Similarly, a very important challenge that occurs before the translator is that of whether the translator can add or remove some text. So these are like very very important challenges, whether prose or poetry being translated should be in the prose or poetic form. So like retaining of form or not adding or deleting something, these are like challenges before the translators. There are other challenges also, and how these challenges occur, let us examine them. So reasons behind the challenges posed before the translators and interpreters is that of like cultural specific phenomena. A lot of things are very culture specific, and they require, in fact, they require equivalents which may not be available. So there are gaps between languages and cultures, and therefore it is difficult for translators or interpreters to express them. And that is where the actual skills and creativity of the translators and interpreters come into play. In the process, occasionally there are like losses, and there are gains, and there are deviations also, termed as divergence. For instance, if I were to ask you to translate all the best in your language, and you'll notice that there is a lot of deviation required, a lot of divergence required when you have to express all the best, or if you were to translate something like holy shit, and these are like things which are very specific to a particular language, and if it were to be transferred in another language, either you would devise a new term which would mean something very different, but they would be contextually fit. So it becomes important for the translators and interpreters to find the appropriate context, and then also accept some loss and gain in the process. Some divergence are like natural, but most often the well-versed or say skilled translators would try their best to minimize them. Then comes the question of readability. If a translation is rendered from one language to another language, how readable it is? For that matter, readability is important for the source text also. The authors writing something need to be aware of the fact that the readers have bigger challenges than them. The readers need to understand that text, and they may have small time to understand that. A writer may have spent, say, 10 years and then come up with a particular work, but the reader may be interested in reading that within a few hours or within a few days. Then the message should be expressed in such a way that the readers are able to follow them. It should be readable for the readers. But if that does not happen, what does the translator do? The translator should at least translate something which is readable. So this readability is an important thing for the translators. Similarly, the authors and writers or speakers should express themselves in such a language that is translatable or interpretable, something that it has less of vagueness, or something that is not very open for interpretation, something that has less of ambiguous sentences unless it is required. So that way, only if a text is translatable or interpretable, the translators and interpreters can perform well. And the translators and interpreters should also understand the pains that they have gone through. They should understand that, and then the text that they are producing, they should also make it like retranslatable and reinterpretable. So that way, they should not speak things or write things which are not further translatable or interpretable. Now, in all these processes, in all these efforts, and in all these goals, what is at our disposal is very important. We have some tools, some things available, and then we make use of them. Before that, let me also introduce you to an argument which we would like to refute. The argument says that somebody proficient in two languages would be able to translate or interpret. So interpretation and translation are language activities, and just because they are language activities, anybody who is proficient in two or three languages would be able to perform that. That means their translation and interpretation activities are seemingly just re-encoding of message. Now this is an argument which has in fact affected the growth of these fields for a long time. Many agencies that engage translators and interpreters believe that, but let me argue against these facts. Just being able to converse freely in two or three languages does not ensure the person to become a good translator or interpreter. In fact, translation and interpretation are very specialized skills. They are very important skills that require training, and it cannot be just based on proficiency in two languages. So we need to understand these facts. Now, what is available at our disposal? What are the challenges? The challenges of extracting meaning from the source text and then transferring that meaning in the target text, for which dictionaries and glossaries, thesaurus, encyclopedia and ontologies are helpful. Translation equivalents and bilingual lexicons are helpful, but then they are helpful at the level of the text. What if the text had extended meaning? What if the text was satirical? What if the text had ironies? In that case, we need to understand that the translators and interpreters need to understand the context of the source text. That means they need to move from text to context. They need to understand the context properly, and only if they are able to understand the context, they would be able to express them in the target language properly. So to understand the context, the translators and interpreters need to understand the intention of the speaker and writer, for which the knowledge of pragmatics is very important. Very often I have noticed that those who are translating or interpreting do not like to read theories, do not like to read linguistics or say ideas from linguistics. All that they believe in is like people are born translators, as if people are born translators and interpreters. One can just render anything from any language to any language. This does not happen actually. In fact, if we examine properly, most translations and interpretations that we are coming across are in need for modification. They are in need for improvement. And that improvement can happen if and only if the translators and interpreters have some knowledge of semantics, some knowledge of pragmatics and semiotics also. So only then they would be able to understand the speaker's intention in fullness and express that in culturally and contextually fit target language. It is also important for them to understand the meaning from signs and symbols, gestures and extra linguistic cues, and then express that in the target language. So they need to understand what is acceptable in the target language, what is the norm in the target language, and how that can best be expressed without causing hurtful sentiments among the prospective readers and listeners. Let me also bring before you some data. In fact, if we were to examine what languages are most translated languages, or what works are most translated works, or what languages are ensuring maximum translation and interpretation activities, we will be very surprised to see that among the top 10, we do not have even one Indian language. Like, the most translated languages include French, German, Russian, Spanish, Italian, Swedish, Danish, Japanese, Czech and Dutch. In case of India, let us see what languages are most translated languages in India. And we notice that we have like English, Sanskrit, followed by Bengali, Hindi, Russian, Urdu, Tamil, Marathi, French and Kannada. What happens to other languages? Like, if we examine the context of India, India is a very diverse, linguistically very rich country, where there has been a tradition of translation also. But in, say, recent centuries, the translation activities have remained focused with some languages, and a lot of languages have remained out of this focus. Now, there is a need to translate a lot in these languages, and there is a need to include these languages in translation activities. Let us also see what works have received maximum attention in translation activities in India. We notice that these are some of the authors who have been translated maximally in India. So Tagore and Vivekananda top, and then William Shakespeare comes on the 10th position. If we look at position of India, India ranks 35th among the most translating nations. Now, considering the linguistic diversity of the country, the richness of languages and linguistic pluralism in this country, there is a need to improve this and there is a need to engage a lot of translation activities, do a lot of translation interpretation, so that India comes in the at least top 10 translating countries. Why would I say that it should just move from 35th to 10th, top 10 countries? The reason is that those countries which are translating a lot are countries which are developed. These are countries that are continually receiving technological and scientific developments, and they are investing a lot on localization, so that the latest developments in technology and scientific fields are available for their masses in their languages. On that front, India needs to work. On that front, if we work, we would be self-reliant on technological and scientific fronts, and we may also sort out the problem of higher education. We may be able to sort out the problem of science education, because if there is a lot of good translation happening and the materials of higher education available in Indian languages, the prospective the people who have received their school education in Indian languages would be finding their materials in their own languages, and they would be developing. They would not face dual challenge of understanding the subject and understanding it in a foreign language or in a language that they do not know. So language becomes a barrier for them. That kind of barrier can be reduced. in India, the I mean, language that like is most translated is Sanskrit. So Sanskrit ranks 30th, Bengali is 39th, and Hindi comes at 45. And these are like major languages. If we look at other languages, if we look at the performance of other languages, we would be very disheartened. And that actually requires our translators to be ready to change these figures within a span of 10 to 15 years, and then bring India to top 10 translating nations, and bring Indian languages among like top 10 languages which receive translation and which also translate into several languages. So that would require a collective effort of translators, interpreters, translation and interpretation agencies, government institutions, and several others, so that it proves to be very, very rewarding for anybody who is engaging with that. Now, if we all decide to just go into translation mode, and we also go into interpretation mode, we may not reach our desired result. It is not something that is very new, which I'm saying. The things that I'm saying are like spoken by several others. Also, the things that I'm bringing before you are common wisdoms also. Things which I'm saying are well understood, even though they are not expressed in these words. The point that is important for us to understand is like what quality of translation and interpretation, how to assess them and how to ensure them. We would be very saddened to know that our assessment of language itself is in need of change. The way schools and colleges and various institutions assess language is problematic. On many occasions, you will notice that mere proficiency is assessed. And sometimes even proficiency is not assessed, rather the ability to remember some words, the ability to recall some vocabulary, the ability to remember stories are assessed in the name of language assessment. When our language assessment is so poor, then how would we expect our translation assessment to be rich? So I would also like to draw your attention to the fact that there is need for assessing translation and quality of translation properly. So that is why we should also develop good parameters for translation and interpretation performances, and we should develop proper norms, proper scales, so that the work can be certified, so that the work can get a license, so that people engaging in such work can also get license and they can be certified. So this is important, not just for the reason that translation and interpretation are activities which are expanding and which are paying. They are also important from the legal and political and academic standpoints, like the books that we may be interested in reading in our own languages need to be translated and interpreted properly. They need to be translated faithfully, and when legal interpretation has to happen, the parties would like to ensure that no injustice happens to anyone, no misrepresentation or misassessment happens there. Then these areas also have socio-cultural manifestations. So the things that are under consideration in translation and interpretation activities need to be fit into the socio-cultural context also. So for all these things, there is a need to assess the quality, there is a need to develop proper parameters to assess the quality and then certify them. Let me also draw your attention to some new trends. If like people become interested in translators and translation and interpretation activities, then it is also important to see what are new trends in these areas. A lot is happening across the globe, and a lot is happening in India also. There is a need to examine what is initiating and how we can engage with these new developments, and how we can invest resources in these areas, and how we can associate for its further development. So one of which is like translators and interpreters education itself. One of these is like skilling the translators and interpreters and training them properly. for which I think Directorate of Languages has taken a good initiative, and for the same, the National Translation Mission has also been actively working by providing training to translators. And in like recent times, it has also started focusing on interpretation, so that translators and interpreters can receive proper training and develop into professionals who do not commit errors. Then testing and evaluation of translation quality and interpretation performance is also very important, because what we test and how we grade a translation or interpretation performance, or say a translator or interpreter, is very important, and it should not be superficial. It should not just be anything. Rather, it should focus exactly on what aspect has been evaluated. When we have very well understood that people take interest in different fields and they have their orientations, maybe somebody is good at literary translation but not very good at technical translation, maybe somebody is good at conference interpreting and not very good at legal interpreting. So these are things that are very specific in nature. These are skills which are very specialized, and the translators or interpreters who are getting licenses and certificates must be examined properly and appropriately. Then there are also needs for like licensing and accreditation of translators properly. So like an agency that can offer them translators and issue them certificates based on which they can get a job, based on which they can be engaged. Like you have the tour guides, or you have doctors and engineers who are certified, or say practitioners of law, advocates, and other like very specialized people. Translators and interpreters also need to be certified properly for their language pairs, for the language pairs in which they can operate, and for the kind of translation and interpretation services they can provide. So in a nutshell, I can say that India is in a need for a regulatory body for translation activities, interpretation activities, certification of translators, licensing and accreditation of translation and translation interpretation, and things associated with both these disciplines. There is also a need for a regulatory body for pricing and quality assurance in these activities, because these are very important skills, very, very interesting areas in which people have just started to enter. And there is a possibility that whimsical pricing can happen based on the need and time available, or maybe. So that way, there is a need for a regulatory body which can state prices, which can like upgrade prices from time to time, so that those engaging in these activities with proper skills are suitably rewarded, they are suitably paid. So far, there are some developments on this front. So far, there are some rates prevalent, but then that way, a proper national level regulatory body is not there. So we have things like NTM rates, or Sahitya Academy rates, or NBT rates. These are like rates at which the quality of translation, or say activity of translation, is paid. For interpretation also, just based on the essentiality, just based on the kind of or sensitivity of the matter, the interpreters are paid. Some of them are very overly paid, some of them are very lowly paid. So there is a need for a balance in the payment also, and it should properly reflect the quality that one can provide, and the pricing should happen in such a way that from time to time it is revised, and it brings appropriate benefits to the translators and interpreters, the professionals engaging in these fields. There is also a need for further development of automated systems for quick translation and interpretation. Like there is a need for proper machine translation. There is a need for machine tools, mobile applications that can render things in the concerned target language appropriately. Now, a lot of development has taken place. You might have observed that Google Translate is also improving day by day. But then we are very saddened to see that all Indian languages are not there. In fact, even all scheduled languages are not there. When all languages are not there, how are we going to manage the needs of these languages which are not available. We cannot blame Google or other internet service providers. Rather, we should examine why this has happened. This has happened because the unavailability of corpus, because of unavailability of digital resources. It is also happening because we have in a way left our languages and we have not been using our languages on the technological platforms, on internet and virtual media. So when the corpus is not available, then how does a machine translation system develop and how can it be made available? Now there are like signs of new changes and we look forward to such changes so that when machine translation develops in other languages, then these are also extended to those languages which were left out. And we have all noticed that on this front, the performance has been improving consistently. So if you examine Google Translate or Microsoft's translation facility, you'll notice that the performance that people used to mock at 5 years ago has become so reliable today, has become so improved today that most of the human translation, or say most of the translators, are also depending on them now. They are continually referring to their own translation and checking for or matching their translations with that, just to ensure that what they have translated is correct. That means these are like areas which are continually improving. What about interpretation? There are fewer or no facilities for automated interpretation system, but with time we look forward to new developments that can ensure automated interpretation facilities also. But for the same, there would be a need for a lot of investment in these areas, a lot of engagement of human resources, and then only some desirable outcomes can be there. Let me bring before you a development that took place in 2017, which I consider very important for translators and interpreters. In the year 2017, the United Nations General Assembly adopted a resolution that recognizes the role of professional translation in fostering peace and causing understanding among nations. And that resolution also declared 30 September as International Translation Day. So this was a new development which recognized the translation and interpretation activities as professional activities, and it's a happy sign for all those engaging in these areas. I should also like to bring before you an interesting fact, that is, like, a lot of translation and interpretation activities are happening in a hidden way. Like the activities are happening, but the agencies who are engaging or the people who are engaging are not fully aware of it. For instance, I mentioned earlier that most of the popular TV programs are available in most languages. When they are available in so many languages, some language experts would be engaged dubbing. They would be providing subtitles, and then a lot of translation is happening through like outsourcing, through some agencies. The problem is that these are not properly organized. The problem is that these are not regulated properly. If all of it were regulated properly and brought under a particular setup, then we would understand the size of industry that translation and interpretation are, or they can be. And then we would realize that translators and interpreters can get into these activities with a sense of pride and without having any feeling of embarrassment or shame. And in fact, one would be very proud to say that I am a professional translator, and he would not feel any way less than a, say, professional engineer or scientist or anyone. So that way, it is very important for us to invest a lot of resources in all possible means and then develop these areas into proper industries and proper like fields that younger population can also take up. Let me also introduce before you some institutions and establishments that have worked on these fronts. And it's my pleasure, my pride, to introduce before you the National Translation Mission, which is working for working as an apex body on translation in this country, and also working for making higher education available in regional languages. For the same, this National Translation Mission engages a lot of translators who would be translating books of higher education in 22 scheduled languages. When National Translation Mission began this kind of a service, it realized that there is a need for training the translators. There is a need to provide skills to the translators, and there is also a need to include language persons, language experts, and then draw their attention to the possibilities with translation. As a result, the National Translation Mission, popularly known as NTM, has been providing training to a lot of translators. And in recent years, when the mission also realized that interpretation is emerging as important area, it has also started including components of interpretation and interpretation studies in its training programs, one of which will be coming very soon also. Then Sahitya Academy is also an institution that should receive our attention. Sahitya Academy has given a lot of support to translation activities. A lot of possibilities are there with Sahitya Academy also in translation, for translators and those who are specializing in translation activities. Then National Book Trust has also engaged translators. These are all institutions that are like paying and they are engaging translators. One institution that is likely to occur, an institution that was announced in the National Education Policy 2020, is the Indian Institute of Translation and Interpretation. And if this institute comes up, we can look forward to most of the things that we have dreamt about, especially in the context of translation and interpretation. Most of the things that we are feeling that they should be available may become available with this kind of an institution, because this would be an institute that would act as a regulatory body, or that would act as a license provider or certification body, that would as institution that has language experts, and then that also provides skill development to translators and interpreters, so that way it can also like provide certificates and licenses to translators. So a lot of possibilities are there with this kind of an institute coming up, and we look forward to such development when the government of India announces it in future. For the time being, let me bring before you a very interesting fact, a very important argument that I often like to discuss with the translators. I would like to bring before you the fact that a translator is not just proficient in two or three languages, or an interpreter is not just proficient in two or three languages. In fact, a translator or interpreter is a bilingual person who is capable of flexibly moving from one worldview to another worldview, from one domain of knowledge to another domain of knowledge. So these are like people who are very skilled, who can express things spoken in one language to another language. It is not just the language here. In fact, these languages embody the worldviews of these speakers, and they are, these like translators and interpreters are able to carry forward one worldview to another worldview. And when they are doing this, they are in fact very rich people. They are enriching their own skills also, and they represent the availability of a very vast domain of knowledge within them. So with that, I would like to conclude here, to allow some time for interactions, questions and answers. And I would like to thank the Directorate of Languages, Government of Goa, for having given me the opportunity to discuss some of these issues. And also, I would like to thank other participants, listeners and viewers on the
Yeah, thank you very much, sir, for the informative session. So today we discussed about basics of translation and also interpretation. Along with that, we also saw types of translation, interpretation, domains of translation and interpretation, also some of the challenges faced by translators. Sir Tariq also shared with us some of the institutions at national level which are doing work in the field of translation and interpretation. Now let's begin with the question and answer session. We have a question from Mr. Bhaskar Shetty. Translation through a third language or translation through help of interpretation without the knowledge of source language, will it find merit as far as target language is concerned?
This question appears to be a yes no question, and it looks like the person who has asked this question is well aware of the fact that the answer would be no. In fact, the translator needs to know. There is a need to know the source as well as target equally well.
Thank you, sir. There is another question. While translating idioms, expressions from source language to target language is a challenge before translator. Now, is it appropriate to translate it contextually, or is it advisable to transliterate it and then give its meaning as a footnote?
This is a very interesting question. And before I provide my answer to it, I would like to say that the choice is with the translator. But then we need to understand, when it is specifically about idioms, we need to understand the point that idioms are expressions where you cannot combine the meaning of individual words and come to the collective meaning. The individual meanings of the words used in an idiom may or may not contribute to the collective meaning or total meaning of that idiom. So it is not very appropriate to transliterate idioms either, because transliteration would be more suitable for technical terms. Transliteration would be more suitable for those concepts, cultural phenomena or certain concepts which are not available in the target language. Now, how does a translator render an idiom from the source text into a target text? There are two possibilities. One possibility is there is an equivalent. That means if the two languages are related, there is a possibility that the target language also has an idiom or a proverb available for that. Or else it can be expressed literally. It can be expressed in normal words, or it may not require an idiom there. So that way, the possibilities are open. If the two languages are not related at all, then again the possibilities are like the translators would express them fully. There are also instances in which the source text does not have an idiom, whereas the target text may require an idiom. So that way, I hope I have been able to understand and answer your question.
Yeah, thank you, sir. There is a last question here. With regards to Kokni language is not yet included in the Google Translate tool. However, some of the translators take help of other languages like Marathi or Hindi while translating text from English to Kokni. So what they do is they put the material on the Google Translate tool in source language, which is English language, and they check the translation in Marathi or Hindi, and then based on that they translate in Kokni language. So how authentic is it to translate using such tool?
The authenticity would be judged by somebody who is well versed in both the languages. Here I am not, but then as far as the process is concerned, I can express my views on that. Since Konkani is a language which is like script-wise very, very rich, and it is written in several scripts, Therefore, it is also a challenge for Google itself to provide facilities for in like a translation from English to Konkani, because you might have noticed that Konkani is written in Devanagari, it is also written in Roman script, it is also written in Gujarati script, it is also written in Kannada script. So there are like several scripts which have worked for Konkani. But then when it comes to developing an automated system for this language, the availability of so many scripts is a deterrent. It is actually playing playing a role of a hindrance. In fact, if the people speaking this language decide to write as much as possible in Konkani in the script that is designated official, and if they are continually putting their text on the virtual platforms, digital corpus would develop. Once the corpus develops, and there are like parallel corpuses of, or parallel corpora of Konkani and English, Konkani and Marathi, then slowly the system of automated translation can also develop. But that is for the development of the translation system for English and Konkani, or say for Konkani. There would be requirement of various other kinds also coming into play, like development of lexical resources, dictionaries, encyclopedias, thesaurus, translation equivalents, and things like that in the concerned language, which are like of bilingual nature. So that way, once the terms are available with the system, available in both the languages appropriately equal, then it is easier for the programmers to devise programs to render the message from one language to another language, and that would help Konkani also.
Yeah, thank you so much, sir. I think there are no more questions for today. Yeah, so now I would request you, if you have any comments before we wind up with our today's session.
I do not have any comment as such. I would just like to thank the Directorate of Languages for collaborating with National Translation Mission for this important lecture series. And it was, I should like to confess here that it was my first occasion hearing so much of Konkani. I have been to Goa physically. I have been present there on two occasions. And I have heard Konkani on that occasion, and then on the virtual platform, of course, this was my first instance when I heard so much of Konkani when you were introducing, and when the honorable director was speaking. So that way, I'm very happy that we have been able to engage with translators who are providing services in English Konkani or Konkani English translation. I would also like to invite them to National Translation Mission. If they are finding time, they should like to join our programs. The National Translation Mission is very soon going to announce a training program of 2 weeks, which would focus on translation and interpretation, both these activities. It would be online, so they can join online. In future, when the pandemic situation improves, we also have residential programs where the interested persons, whether they are language experts or they are translators, can visit the institute and stay here, mingle with language translators of from across the country, and then engage in some real translation activities. Apart from that, Konkani is one of the scheduled languages, and it is an important language for the National Translation Mission. Also, we have been working on translation of higher education textbooks from English to Konkani. So if there are viewers, if there are translators who are listening to me right now, they would be interested, and they are in fact invited to get in touch with the National Translation Mission and then find some possibilities for themselves. That's all for the time being. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, sir. With this, I would like to thank Dr. Tariq Khan for such an informative session. As you said, sir, translation is a specialized skill which requires training and proficiency. I hope that this session and this lecture series helps translators from Goa and also across the world in translation process and also in interpretation process. Dr. Tariq will also join us on 6th of September. The topic of that session would be translation in complementary role with literature and linguistics. Tomorrow, we have a session at 10:30 a.m. by Dr. Geeta Kumari V, the Chief Resource Person, National Translation Mission, Central Institute of Indian Languages, Mysore. The topic of the session is translation strategies. एक सत्र आयोजित करता म्हणल्यार ताच्या फाटल्यान खूप जणांचो आधार लागता. खूप जण ताच्या खातीर धडपडटा. डायरेक्टरेट ऑफ ऑफिशियल लँग्वेज, राजभास संचालनालयाचे कर्मचारी, टेक्निकल तसेच ॲडमिनिस्ट्रेटिव्ह स्टाफ, आमचे संचालक, सहायक संचालक, वरिष्ठ भाषांतरकार हांच्या सहकार्यान हे व्याख्यान ही व्याख्यानमाळा आयोजित करप शक्य झाले. हांव हांगा उपकाराचे उलोप करताना सगळ्यांत पयली आमच्या गोय सरकाराचे तशेंच राजभाषा संचालनालयाचे सचिव हांचे उपकारी आसा. हे व्याख्यानमाळ आयोजित करूंक ताणें आमकां मान्यताय दिली. तशेंच नॅशनल ट्रान्सलेशन मिशन, सेंट्रल इन्स्टिट्यूट ऑफ इंडियन लँग्वेजीस, मैसूर. सर, वी आर ग्रेटफूल टू यू फॉर कोलॅबरेटिंग विथ अस टू ऑर्गनायज दीस लेक्चर सिरीज. We are also thankful to the academic faculty and staff of NTM CIL Mysore. Our live streaming host Palash Agni Studios, ami tumche upkari asa hi karyavar YouTube acher live stream karpak amka khup moladik tumi sahkarya dile. Print media ani electronic media amka segit hya vyakhyan male khatir tumi prasiddhi dili. ताच्या खातीर आमी तुमचे उपकारी आसा. द गव्हर्मेंट एम्प्लॉईज, टीचर्स, ट्रान्सलेटर्स, स्टुडंट्स अँड ऑल द लँग्वेज एन्थुझियास्ट हू जॉईन्ड अस टुडे ऑन यूट्यूब टू व्ह्यू दीस लेक्चर, आमी तुमचे उपकारी आसा. आणि सेगीत 8 दीस चलपी ह्या व्याख्यानमाळेत तुम्ही आमकां जोडटले अशी हांव आस्त बाळगिता. फाल्यांचे सत्र 10:30 वरांचेर जातले. तुमकां सगळ्यांक विनवणी आसा ह्या व्याख्यानमाळेक आमकां सहकार्य दिवचे. सगळ्यांक देव बरे करूं.